Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Today we'll talk about, the title of this talk is around Borsuk's problem.
Okay, so I will talk about the Borsuk problem. I think I'd rather use this whiteboard than that whiteboard. And the problem is, let me introduce the problem. So let f of d be the smallest integer such that every set x in Rd of diameter 1 can be covered by f of d set of smaller diameter. And the Borsuk problem or Borsuk conjecture was that f of d is d plus 1. So he asked, is it true that every set of diameter 1 in Rd can be covered by d plus 1 sets of smaller diameter? And why d plus 1? So let me explain perhaps what was the motivation behind this conjecture. So I think the first thing to notice is that you cannot do better than d plus 1. You definitely cannot cover a set of diameter 1, every set of diameter 1, by less than, by d sets of smaller diameter. Why is that? Or is it clear to everybody? And the reason is that, so you need d plus 1, since there are d plus 1 equilateral points in Rd. So in Rd you can find d plus 1 points so that the distance between any two of them is 1. So for example, in the plane you can find 3 points that this is 1, this is 1, and this is 1. In general, in Rd you can find d plus 1 such points. So clearly if you have this d plus 1 points and the distance between every two is 1, then if you divide them to d parts, one of the parts will still contain two of the points, and the diameter of this part will still be 1. So this is definitely a reason that you cannot make a stronger conjecture. There is another fact, which is deeper, which says that if a b is a ball of diameter 1, so if B is a ball of diameter 1, radius 1 half, then you cannot cover the ball of diameter 1 by D sets of smaller diameter. So this is a deep, so Borsuk Ulam theorem, which is a deep, result in topology, says that you cannot cover B by D sets of smaller diameter, or another way to formulate it, whenever you cover the ball, the unit ball, by D sets, by D closed set, one of the sets will contain two antipodal points. But you can cover it, you can cover by D plus 1 is okay. So you can cover the ball by d plus 1 set of smaller diameter, say here I cover the two-dimensional ball, and so since the ball is the largest set in terms of the volume whose diameter is 1, then you can guess that maybe this is the worst case. And if you can cover the ball in dimension D with D plus 1 set of smaller diameter, then you can cover any other set of diameter 1 with D plus 1 sets. So this is the origin of Borsuk problem. And already when Borsuk asked it, there was another important piece of information, and this is that it's true for D equal 2, it is true. And why is it true? The reason is that if you have a set of diameter 1 in R2, it was known since the beginning of the 20th century. So this conjecture was in the 30s, I think 1933. It was known since the beginning that you can put every such set inside the hexagon of where this hexagon, the distance between two parallel, this is a regular hexagon where the distance between two parallel edges is 1. So every set of diameter 1 can be inscribed into such a hexagon. Now this hexagon has a diameter which is bigger than 1, but still you can split it to 3 parts of smaller diameter. So this hexagon, if I consider these 3 areas, this one and that one and say that one, then these areas are of smaller diameter, and this, after you prove that indeed such a hexagon can be found, this gives you a proof in dimension 2. And indeed, afterwards, it was proved for D equals 3. So D equals 3 is also true. This was proved in the 60s and 70s, and one of the proofs used similar idea as this proof, namely using some universal set or one parameter set, family of universal sets, which are sufficient to include all the sets of diameter 1. And also it is true, so Borsuk conjecture is also true when X has a smooth boundary. So if the set has a smooth boundary, then the assertion of the conjecture is true. In fact, it's not so difficult. And also it's true if X is centrally symmetric. So this means, centrally symmetric means that if X belongs to X, this implies minus X belongs to X. And finally, it is, or maybe I'll mention it later, you can consider only very special type of sets. So Borsuk conjecture, and more generally, the determination of FOD, it's enough to consider sets which have diameter 1 and are maximal with respect to having diameter 1. Now, sets which have diameter 1 and are maximal with respect to this property are called sets of constant width 1. Now, it's not commonly known, even among mathematicians, that there are sets of constant widths which are not the ball. Even they are not the circle, say, in the plane. So the circle indeed has a constant width in each direction. Every direction you measure it, you look at this width, it's always 1, if this radius is 1/2. But there are other sets of constant widths. This is the famous set is the Reylot triangle, where you start with equilateral triangle of edge length 1, and then you draw an arc, so this is 1, from each vertex to the opposite. And this will give you something which is, which actually have corners. So you'll have corners, and so it will be more, so it will not be a circle, and this have, you can show that this have constant width 1. So in any dimension, there are such sets, and you can reduce every set of diameter 1 is included in a set of constant width 1, and therefore the conjecture reduces to such set. Okay, so this is the introduction, and then the somewhat surprising fact Oh, let me mention that although the conjecture was that f of d is equal to d plus 1, the best bounds were much larger. So there were several bounds, let me mention only two. Lasak, a Polish mathematician, proved that f of d is less or equal to 2 to the d minus 1 for every dimension, in a very elegant proof. And then this is Lasak, and then Schramm, Odette Schramm, who is here, proved that f of d is less or equal to 3 over 2, square root 3 over 2 to the power d. So this is about 1.2 to the power d times, say, I think 1 plus little of 1 or something like that. So it's an asymptotic result. So this was proved by Schramm, and Schramm's proof used the fact that you can... he used the reduction set of constant widths, and after you know that, and this set of constant widths, not only that he covered them by this number set, this number of sets, but he covered them by small homotets of themselves. So this is a stronger statement. He considered sets of constant widths and covered them by small homotets of themselves. Yes?
What's a homotet?
It's something where you just shrink it a little bit. Okay. So you take the original set and shrink it a little bit. So this is not true. Not every set can be covered. For now, if you take the cube and you want to cover it by small homotets of itself, then you need 2 to the t, 2 to the d, copies of the cubes. But for sets of constant widths, this number is enough. And then Burgen and Linnestrauss found yet another proof of precisely the same bound, square root 3 over 2 plus little of 1 to the power d. Sorry, also here the little of 1 is here, which make it a little worse. And their proof is based on yet another idea. They cover the set by balls. So if you cover the set by balls, you don't matter if it's the same diameter or smaller diameter, because we already saw every ball can be covered by d plus 1 sets. But they show that every set of diameter 1 can be covered by this number of balls of diameter 1, or diameter slightly smaller than 1. And here it's known, for this problem, it's known that you cannot go lower than some other exponential, something like 0.0001 to the d. This is something which was proved by Ganzer. Anyway, so this was the situation. And it looked at the gap between the conjecture and the upper bound was quite bad. And then it turns out that the conjecture is false. So this was proved by Jeff Kahn and me in 1993. So theorem said that f of d is greater or equal to 1.2 square root d. And the Borsuk conjecture is false for dimension, I think we proved it for all dimensions greater or equal to 1,500 or something like that. So in very high dimension, the conjecture is false. And in a minute, I'll show you why is it false. Let me mention some obvious questions. So obvious questions are how f of d behaves. So it's either, is it exponential, or does it behave like a something which is sub-exponential, so is it? I would tend to guess that the answer is closer to really being exponential. And also, what about f of 4? Is f of 4 equal 5? And so, other questions. Okay, so this is the background. And indeed, it turns out that the proof of Borsuk. Since then, these bounds, which was, maybe 1,500, a little bit, there were some dimensions below it, which it's known to be false, but above 1,000, was lowered. And now the world record is for every d greater or equal to 298, it's false. And this was proved by Hinrichs and Richter. And there was a sequence of improvements. But still, I would say the situation is still far from being understood. Okay, so let me mention what is involved in making the proof. Okay, so what is involved in the proof? So let's consider ED is the space of lines. So the origin, so zero in RDE, and the distance between two lines, the distance between two lines is the maximum angle, is the angle between them, sorry. So two lines determines two angles. You take the smallest angle, and this is the distance between two lines. So the space of lines through RD, which sometimes called the elliptic space or the real projective space, this is a metric space. And what is the diameter of this metric space?
180 degrees.
What?
180 degrees.
Yeah, 180 degrees or pi over 2. So the...
Pi.
Pi, sorry.
But it's actually 90 degrees.
It is 90 degrees. Oh, okay, so 90 degrees. So it is pi over 2.
90, right.
Yeah, so you have... No, if you have these two, we count the smallest thing. All right, so it's pi over 2. And we can ask the same question. If we want to cover this space by a small, by sets of smaller diameter, how many sets do we need? And then there is a theorem which says that ED cannot be covered by less than 1.2 to the D sets of diameter less than pi over 2. So this is a theorem. This is essentially a theorem of Frankel-Wilson. I'll also explain to you how to prove this theorem. And essentially, the point is that if you have a set, you know, if you cover this space by sets where the diameter is less than pi over 2, each such set do not contain two perpendicular lines. And it turns out that if you have a collection of lines where no two are perpendicular, this causes severe restriction. And this is the origin of this. So I should say this is true only, this is not only if D is equal, I think, 4 P and P is a prime, and for general dimensions, slightly, this should be replaced by 0.001 to the D or something like that, but this is a technical point. I will explain it in a moment, but okay, let's start from here. So this is this is a known theorem. And then the question is how this space is not the RD. It's a strange space, strange metric space. And then what is the relation? So one way to present our proof is that this space ED can be isometrically, let me put here in parentheses because maybe the distance will not be the angle, but cosinus the angle or something like that. But essentially, it's isometrically embedded in RD in R D square. And the idea of this embedding is very simple. You represent a line, so a line is represented by some x in RD, where the norm of x is 1. And then you replace x by x tensor x, where x tensor x is, you can think about it as the matrix, xi if x1 up to xn, then x tensor x is the matrix, xi, xj, where I and j are between 1 and n. Okay? Yes?
The distance, the cosine of the angle, you get distance of 0 in one space becoming distance, maximum distance in the other space. It's funny.
Oh, okay, so maybe not the cosine, sine of the angle. So, okay, so look at this embedding. And then what happened is that the inner product, so you see, first of all, note that if you take minus x, we get the same minus x tensor, minus x is the same as x tensor x, and then you have only to notice that the inner product of x tensor x and y tensor y is the same as the inner product of x and y times the inner products of a square. Yeah, this follows immediately. And therefore, you have x tensor x is also a unit vector. So x tensor x is also a unit vector. And the angle between two such vectors is is always, the inner product of two such vectors is always greater or equal to zero. This means that the angle between two such vectors is always less or equal pi over 2. And it's equal pi over 2. So x tensor x is perpendicular to y tensor y if and only if x is perpendicular to y. So this is 0 if and only if this is 0. And therefore, what you get here is an embedding. So you get here an embedding of the elliptic space into a d squared dimensional space. Actually, if you are very pedantic, you can notice that this practically is only a d plus 1 choose 2 dimensional space because this is a symmetric matrix. This doesn't matter. So you have an embedding of the elliptic space into Rd square, and therefore if you consider, for example, the space of, so if you consider just all the image, so the conclusion is that the set of x tensor x, where x is of norm 1, cannot be covered by less than 1.2 to the d sets of smaller diameter. And this is, and 1.2 to the d, now it's something like 1.2 to the dimension, square root of the dimension. So this is the proof. Okay, so this part of the proof. And now I must say that this set, so this is a counterexample. This is a counterexample to Borsuk conjecture. And actually, you don't have to take all these vectors. You can take some configuration of vectors. And indeed, in the original proof, so this is a counterexample in high dimension. And you can take configurations of points. So you can take only x to be only a plus minus 1 vectors up to scaling. So this was essentially the original proof, and you can take other configurations. So the present improvement of the bounds is obtained by using a similar idea, although not precisely the same, and basing it on configuration which come from the Leech lattice. So to go down to dimension 228, you need some configuration which are based on the Leech lattice, and then you need some argument like that which take the more or less the square of the dimension, or square over 2 of the dimension. Okay, and this is a familiar convex set. This is the set of rank 1 positive semi-definite matrices. And even this particular set, if you take plus minus 1 vector, is also a famous set which was considered before this. It's called the cut polytopes. So the set that turns out to be a counterexample to the Borsuk problem is quite well known. So let me mention the first problem I would like to ask. So problem A, you see that you don't really need isometric embedding of the elliptic space to make this proof work. So perhaps one question is, maybe you can embed isometrically the elliptic space in lower dimensions. Actually, I don't know the answer. It is believed that, some people believe that here there are equilateral sets of size d squared. And if this is the case, then you cannot save here essentially d squared. I mean, d times d minus 3 over 2 or something. And this is the known upper bound. And if you can meet this upper bound, then you cannot save here with isometric embeddings. The largest size of a set of equilateral set here is about d to the 3 halves. There are such sets based on the Hadamard matrices. So this shows that, you know, maybe this can be pushed a little further, but not all the way to exponential bound. Now, one interesting question is that actually you don't really need that the embedding will be isometric. All you care is that the maximal distance here, pairs of vertices of maximal distance here are transformed to pairs of vertices of pairs of points of maximal distance here, but for smaller distances, you don't mind if there are some distortion of the metric. So essentially, you allow in order the construction will work, you can allow some much more relaxed embedding of the elliptic space into Euclidean space. And perhaps the first question, which I found it interesting, is can you improve the bounds by finding, a less symmetric embedding with some distortion? So this is the first problem. And I should say, on passing, that it will also be interesting to understand what is the largest number of lines in a d-dimensional space, that the angle between every two of them is the same. So this is another related problem that...
Ignore the of quotients. Wondering if we ignore the smallest. I just care that orthogonality should be mapped onto the same distance. And of course, I just pick a vector for each line.
Well, okay. I didn't understand the question. So let me mention another question, which is a natural ask, this is problem B. This problem is due to, I forgot. It's a complicated name, but Witzenhausen. What is the maximal volume of a subset or measure of a subset of S of the sphere, S d minus 1, such that, or if you want, you can take the elliptic space, so it just each point there is represented by two points here, such that, so what's the maximum subset X of S d minus 1, such that for every X and Y in X, X is not orthogonal. So this is a very nice problem, and there is a natural answer, or proposed answer. The natural answer is you take a spherical cup, open spherical cup of diameter pi over 4. So you can take around the North Pole a spherical cup of diameter pi over 4, and you can also add around the South Pole a spherical cup of radius pi over 4. And for this set, you see that if you have two vectors here, their angle can be at most, it must be less than pi over 2. And if they're here, also less than pi over 2. And if one from here and one from here, it's bigger than pi over 2. So you don't have two orthogonal. So the conjecture is that the answer is that 2 times the volume of the cap of radius pi over 4. And if you can prove this, that this is indeed the best, this will immediately improve the bounds for how many sets of smaller diameter are needed to cover the elliptic space, and subsequently you could reduce the dimension bounds for Borsuk problem for something around the 70. And this looks like a very fascinating problem. I'll immediately show you that indeed, the fact that this space needs a lot of sets to cover it, and the proof I will mention now gives some bounds on this problem, but not the optimal bound. So it's very interesting problem. I should mention that there are several techniques which are, for example, you can ask, you can look for the volume of a set so that every x and y, the inner product of x, y is less or equal to alpha. So if you demand such a condition, then this is an isoperimetric type result. And then the answer is known precisely, and there are very good techniques to answer such questions and related questions. So if you want that the distance, the angle between two vectors is small, then the best thing you can do in terms of volumes is take a spherical cap. This is more or less the classical isoperimetric result, and there are many, many proofs, many techniques are available for such a problem. There is an opposite problem which calls for sets so that x, y, the inner product is greater or equal to alpha. And this is the question of finding a good spherical code. You want points. Well, what can be said about the size of a family where the distance is always greater than some constant? This is called spherical code. Again, there are techniques based on linear programming. Essentially, it's variants of what can be called the eigenvalue method or spherical harmonics or something like that. And they are quite powerful. And we are interested in question to find the set where the inner product is not equal to alpha. And also here there are some techniques which are algebraic combinatorial. And these techniques, we don't know how to apply them directly to this problem. So we apply them to some other problem, and then there is some loss in this application, which it would be nice to gain back. Okay, so so how do you show that a set of lines with no two perpendicular lines must be small? So instead of looking at all the lines, you look only at lines which are determined by plus minus one vectors. So let me show you now. I'll give you, so in the next 10 minutes, I will show you the fact that this elliptic space cannot be covered by small number of sets. And this, with what I already show you, will give you a complete self-contained explanation of why Borsuk conjecture is so terribly false. And this is a nice technique that if you don't know, it's a nice opportunity to get acquainted with. So we will talk about, and you will see also some problem with this technique. So we will consider plus minus one vectors, plus minus one vectors of length n, and n will be 4p, and p will be a prime. So one problem with this technique of proof is that it works only for very special thing. And we will also, since we don't distinguish between a vector when it's negative, we'll assume, so the vectors are x1 up to xn, we will assume that x1 is 1 and that the number of 1s is even. Okay, so we have these vectors, okay? So we have vectors of plus minus 1, even number of 1, the first coordinate is 1. Altogether, we have 2 to the n minus 2 such vectors. Let's call G the set of all such vectors. And let's consider F to be a subset of vectors with no pair of orthogonal and what I would like to show to you is that every such family must be very small. And for this setting, we will essentially prove, perhaps up to a factor of 2, which is, we don't mind, this statement, this geometric statement, or the combinatorial analog of this statement. But this is only for this plus minus 1 setting. Okay, so Are you ready for the proof? So we have the set of all plus minus 1 vectors of length n, where the first coordinate is 1. And we consider a subset of such vectors with no pair of orthogonal vectors. And what I will show to you is that the size of f is less or equal to n choose 0 plus n choose 1 plus so on plus n choose n over 4 minus 1. And this is roughly 2 to the entropy of 1 quarter n, so it's exponentially smaller than 2 to the n. Why is it the case? So what is the trick? What is the method? And so there will be a method, and then there will be a trick. And the trick is, so the trick, which is crucial, is if x and y belong to this family G, and their inner product is 0 modulo p, let me say this. If x, y belong to G, okay, and their inner product is 0 modulo p, then x is equal to y. Okay? So this is a trick which saves you somehow factor of 4 somewhere. If you have two vectors whose inner product is 0 modulo p, then they must be the same. Why is this the case? So the first thing to observe, which is an easy lemma, this is the lemma, is that the inner product of two vectors is always 0 modulo 4. So this is a crucial fact. The reason the proof works is because of this fact. And this I leave as an exercise. This is very easy to verify. So the inner product of two vectors is always 0 modulo 4. And therefore, if the inner product is 0 modulo p, it's 0 modulo 4p, and since we excluded a vector in its negative, if it's 0 modulo 4p, the two vectors must be the same. Okay. So this is the trick. Now comes the method. Okay, so is it clear? Now comes the method. So this I should say that this theorem is due to Frankel and Wilson. This proof is essentially due to Alone, Baba, and Suzuki. And
don't you want them? They are equal, or then they are
orthogonal? Then they are, I'm sorry, then they are orthogonal. Then x, y is 0. So then... Yeah, then they are orthogonal. And right. So if we have two points in F, then if they are 0 modulo p, then they must be equal. Every point is orthogonal to itself. So if x and y belong to f, then x. Okay, now comes the method. The method is based on the following idea. I think perhaps a baby example of this idea is in the following question that I was asked when I was a child. Can you evaluate this product, x minus 8? You already know this. No, this x minus b times x minus c all the way to x minus z.
You know what? Find the coefficient of x to the power of 13 in this.
So what is the value of this? So the value is 0 because here you have x minus 8. Okay. So this is essentially what we will use. So you consider polynomials in n variables, x1 up to xn, modulo p, and you will, for every vector v in f, there is a polynomial, or consider the polynomial f p of v, and p of v defined as follows. P of v for x1 up to xn is equal to the product I from 1 to p minus 1. Now the inner product of x and v, so x is the vector x1 up to xn, and v is our vector. So this is vector of variables, and v is a vector of some numbers modulo, minus I. Okay? So this is the polynomial. This is a polynomial in n variables. What is the degree of this polynomial? Well, slowly. What is the degree of this polynomial? P minus 1. Yes, okay. So this is the... Okay, now what is the property? Okay, so for every vector, we associated a polynomial. Now, what is the... Now, I want the following property. If we take the polynomial which corresponds to V, and we substitute U, and U belong to F, and V belong to F, then the result is zero, and U is not V. So this is one fact, and the other fact is that if we take P of V and substitute V, then the result is not zero. These are the two facts. Why is this the case? So first of all, PV with U. So we know that the inner product of V and U is not zero. And therefore, it is something which is not zero. And now, we take the product, we take the inner product, we deleted 1, 2, 3, 4, up to P minus 1. So whatever the inner product was, one of the elements in this product is zero. So this is, and therefore, the value is zero. Now, why is it true that PV of V is not zero? Because the inner product of V with itself is zero. And therefore, this product is P minus 1 factorial times some sign. And P minus 1 factorial is not zero modulo P. What? Okay, so this is the fact. Okay, now we need still another, I would say, this is ad hoc trick. This is more or less of a already streamlined trick. So another trick. So you see, now you see that this condition implies that these polynomials are linearly independent. We will see it perhaps with detail in a minute. But now there is another trick which allows us to reduce the space of polynomials that we consider. Now, these polynomials can have powers. So x1 can appear with some... It can have monomials where the powers of the variables can be large. But we know that we can do the following reduction. Every time we see xi square, we replace it by 1. Now, why do we do this reduction? Why this? Now, I claim that when you do this type of operation, the values on plus minus 1 vectors will not change, because 1 square is 1 and minus 1 square is 1. So if we reduce this polynomial to square-free polynomial by this trick, then this property will remain valid. So another trick is reduce PV to PV bar, which is square-free. And now this condition will still be true, and this implies that PV, for V belong to F, are linearly independent. Why? Because if you had a linear combination, if you had a linear combination of the PV, which add up to zero, if you have some lambda V PV equal to zero, and let's say that lambda V is not, okay, let's say lambda V0 is not zero, then you substitute V0. So you take sum of lambda V PV at V0, and this, everything will be zero, except this will be lambda V0 PV0 at V0, and this is not zero, because this is not zero, and this is not zero. Okay, so this is the proof. So they are linearly independent. Now comes the punchline. The space of all polynomial of degree P minus 1 with n variables, which are square-free, is a linear space whose dimension is this number. Okay, so if you have a set of linearly independent polynomial in this space, then the number, so the size of F is less or equal to the dimension of a square three polynomials of degree P minus 1 with n variables. Okay, this is the end of the proof. So this is a very nice algebraic technique, and it would be very nice if you could apply this technique to the to the continuous version. So when you consider not only plus minus one vectors, but arbitrary vectors, perhaps you should think about some other alphabet rather than plus minus one. It's not clear how to weight a set, because the measure of the set is not, need not be precise. I mean, you have to be careful about several things, but it would be nice to extend this method to this question. And another thing which would be very nice, to find another proof, other proofs, some other form of understanding of this Frankel-Wilson theorem, which is based on some of the other rich techniques we have to deal with the 0-1 vectors and the discrete cube and so on. So this is, okay. So this was the proof. So now you have, if you listen carefully, perhaps some of you already saw it, but you have seen the complete story concerning a Borsuk problem. Okay, so I already mentioned the problem of the largest volume. Let me mention a few other problems. The next problem, which is a geometric problem, asks the following. So this is problem C. What is the maximum volume of a constant with set, say constant width set in RD? Oh, I'm sorry, not the maximum, the minimum.
Minimum.
The maximum volume is attained by the ball. This is the isoperimetric. But what is the minimum? And in particular, is it exponentially smaller than the volume of a ball? So this is a very nice question. If it's really interesting.
It's solved for two.
What?
It's solved for d equals two, there's a solution.
Right. So we.
Period.
For d equal 2, the answer is the Reuleau triangle. So this remark was made by Michael Kalai. He has precisely the same last name as mine. He also did his PhD with the same teacher. So this can give you a wrong statistical conclusion about the number of people with this name, or about the number of people in Israel in general. Just a coincidence, yeah. Okay. So, and we are also not relatives.
But we're friends.
We are friends, yeah, definitely. So in d equal 2, it's known. And the question here is the asymptotic question. And if the answer is no, then Schramm's argument would imply that the 3 over 2 to the d could be replaced by 4 over 3 to the d. So it will be interesting. But this seems to be quite a basic question by its own right. I think sets of constant widths, they are really quite remarkable. They can revolutionize manholes, because the reason that a manhole is with a circular, the talk was quite gloomy, and I didn't make any jokes until this point, but I think I had 10 more minutes, but I cannot continue this way. So if a manhole, if you have a manhole, which the real reason that a manhole is circular is that the cover will not fall down. If you have a manhole like this, then you move it, it falls out. And this would work. So essentially, I don't see any reason why manholes are circular and not Reuleau triangles. What? Actually, in the committee for the Challenger disaster, one of the explanations, perhaps not the most important explanation, but one of the explanations is that the people who designed some of the measure tools overlooked the fact that there are sets of constant widths which are not circular. So they had this booster rocket, and there was some complicated tool to measure the widths of the rocket in different angles. And the assumption was that once this fits into the width of the width it should be, then the set itself is very close to to the set it should be. So this was a logical mistake. Probably it's not the main reason for the disaster, but in any case, it is mentioned in the committee finding. So this is, there is, it's very hard to compute. There is a very specific a candidate that it's sort of nice, which I don't know how to compute, and this is the following inductive construction. You suppose you have a set in RD. So this is RD. This is RD, and you have here a set of content widths 1, which I call K0. Now you can construct a new set by the following procedure. The procedure is different above the plane. So here, this is RD plus 1. And above this hyperplane and below, you'll have two different rules. So above, you take every point x so that the distance of x with every point here is at most 1. Okay, so here you take all the x so that dxy is greater or equal to 1 for every y in k0. Less or equal 1, yeah. This is better. This is k plus. And below, k minus is all the set x which belong to all the bz1 so that bz, or belong to the intersection of all bz1 so that this b contain k0. So you look at all the balls of radius 1 that contain our original set, intersect all of them, and take the intersection with the lower hyperplane, with the points where the new coordinate is negative. And if you do this construction, you get a constant width set in one higher dimension. For example, if you start with a line segment, then above this line, you have to take these two things, this creature, because all this, a point, in order to be of distance at most 1 from all these points, it's enough to be of distance at most 1 from this point and from this point, and this gives you this creature. And the intersection of all the balls of radius 1, which contain this line segment, below the line is this thing. So you get the Reylow triangle. And you can continue, and from the Reylow triangle get a new set, and the new set. So I don't know. This is a good question. You know, everybody asks himself this question, but I don't know to do the same trick. I don't know what does it mean to do the same trick.
It's not enough to take the intersection of spheres at the vertices, because points on the edges have a larger width, opposite edges. So you need to shave edges.
So it is true that the simplex is contained in a set of constant widths, but... Let me mention two more problems. Problem D, you can consider, so suppose you have x in RD, and let's say that the diameter of x is less or equal to 1. So we can construct a hypergraph. Let's call it hi of x. And this is all the s in x, so that the size of s is I. And for every x and y in s, so that x is not y, the distance between x and y is 1. So the graph, we can call it the Borsuk hypergraph of x. Let me write it. So this is the Borsuk hypergraph. So if I equal to 2, then this is just the graph of vertices of distance 1. And if I is equal to 3, this is the hypergraph of triangles, equilateral triangles of edge length 1, and so on. So this is a graph which is clearly related. I mean, if you consider a finite set, then Borsuk problem is essentially about the chromatic number of this graph for I equal 2. And there are some interesting problems. So let me mention that it can be shown that the BD plus 1 of X, the number of regular simplices, so that edge length 1, this is less or equal to 1. So in every set, you can have at most 1 d plus 1 tuples of points. Every set of diameter 1, you can have only 1 d plus 1 tuple of points of edgeless 1. There is a conjecture by Schur, that b d of x, if x is of size n, if you have n points, then the number of d-regular simplices, if you have n points so that the diameter is 1, the maximum distance 1, the number of regular simplices with d vertices is at most n. This is known for n equal 2, for d equal 2, it is known. Yes, if you have n points, the maximal distance can be realized at most n times. And Schur proved it for d equals 3. I should say this is... Yeah, this is not the famous Schur. This is Zvi Schur. He was a... He did his PhD with Chaim Hanani on this problem, and he managed to prove for d equals 3. His letters to Hanani, I mean, this was before email. His letter to Hanani remained, and he expressed his frustration that his method seems weaker and weaker as the dimension go up. And recently, Kupitz and Perles went over the proof for d equals 3 and streamlined it and published it. And for general dimensions, this is open. And I think this is a nice conjecture. So, okay, and the last problem I want to mention is how to save Borsuk problem altogether. And you see, there is something about the configuration which comes from the point example of Borsuk conjecture, which give the feeling that this is sort of a special type of configuration. And maybe if you have something which is more regularized, then you cannot find such an example. And there is recently a notion which fits into this, and this is notion of transversality, or a strong Arnold property, which enable to formulate somewhat some variant of the problem, which can be true. And now suppose we have a graph G. G is a graph. And now we want to realize G as the graph of maximum distances, of the graph of maximum distances of n points. So this is a graph with n vertices. The graph of maximum distances of n points in RV. But we want some extra conditions. So if we look at n points in RD, the space of distances, there are n choose 2 distances. So we can look at the R n choose 2. This is the distances between every 2 points. And now the actual distances which come from points from RD are not n choose 2 dimension. What is the dimension of the manifold of distances between n points? This is some lower dimensional manifold. What is its dimension? No, we cannot prescribe n choose 2 distances. There is some condition between them.
Dn.
Essentially, dn minus d plus 1 choose 2. So the space of n vectors is dn dimensional, but as far as the distances are concerned, if we rotate it or we translate it, the pairwise distances are not changed. So we get this space. So in this, so we have here some manifold of this dimension here, and now when we say that this graph is the graph of maximum distances, it means that we have some hyperplane, so we have some hyperplane in this Rn choose 2, and this hyperplane tells us that the pairwise distances, say, are equal to 1 for the edges of this graph. And we want to...
No, it's not a hyperplane.
It's an affine plane.
What is the plane again?
The FM plane specifies one of the conditions that I want. The distances between the pairs of vertices of the graph say equal 1. So we have here a plane. So we want to realize the graph. So we have here a plane which gives the condition that the pairwise distances are 1. We have some extra condition which says that all the other distances are smaller than 1. But we want, so the strong Arnold or transversality property says that the intersection of this hyperplane with the manifold is transversal. So another way to say it, if we make an arbitrary, we assign an arbitrary distance to this, to the edges of the graph, we perturb a little bit the distance from 1 to, say, 1 plus epsilon of the edge, then we can still realize it by some configuration of points. So this means that this configuration is not coincidental. Every nearby pair prescription can also be realized. So this gives a very different nature of graphs that can be realized as maximum distances graphs. And this is very similar to the type of condition we see in the Colin de Verdier theory of graph. I suppose you heard some conjecture. And the conjecture is that if we assuming transversality, there is another formulation. This also says that there is no stress on this configuration, but I'm not defining. Assuming transversality, the chromatic number of G is less or equal to D plus 1. So the Borsuk conjecture still holds if we consider configuration of points where maximum distances are not some unbearable coincidence, but they are really somehow. So this is still open. This is entirely of different nature because just from degrees of freedom, we have a bound of roughly 2D. So here the question is to pin it down to D plus 1. Okay, so I think this is a good place to stop. So thank you very much.
Questions? I actually have a couple of... In this conjecture, so if we look at B2 of x,
yeah,
number of edges, that's linear also in three dimensions.
Right, in three dimensions it's still linear. Yes.
So it's true that BD minus 1x is still linear?
BD minus 1, yeah, this is still considerable. It's still linear. Yeah. But no, I mean, linear with coefficient.
The other one is just a remark that the strong Arnold property is not named after Schwarzenegger.
Okay, I mean. Yeah, and the strong is an adjective for property or for Arnold? There is also the weak Arnold property.
Must be.
So if you want to know more about the stronger Arnold property,